Good morning, folks. I'm Mani. I think Srikanth gave a very good introduction of what I'm going to talk. Probably he covered more than what I'm going to cover today. So to start off, I'll just skip the first few slides because we know how Wi-Fi is evolving, where and all it is used. It is everywhere. See, we need a Wi-Fi here in this hall to connect, to keep track of what we are doing even, right? So it is everywhere. It is penetrating into the home. It is penetrating into the enterprise world. And it is becoming very dense. And you can see how the global reach is for the Wi-Fi. It is like, it is growing and growing and growing. Between the last 2011 to 2018, you can see that it is like 200x fold improvement, actually, in terms of how Wi-Fi is being used, how it is evolving, and how it's penetrating. And a very quick thing on how Wi-Fi standards have evolved in three different dimensions. One is like on the spectrum side. On the other is on the spatial side, and other is on the modulation side. I think the audience here is probably well aware of these things. So I'll just skip those and move into the newest standard, 11AX. 11AX is the buzzword in the Wi-Fi, more than what it was for 11AC or 11AD, actually. Okay, so here I have just tried to quickly give an overview of at the PHY level, how 11AC and 11AX differs. If you look at it, I think Srikanth already covered it anyway, so I'll just give a quick walkthrough. So spectrum-wise, 11AC was only alluding to 5 gigahertz, so it was excluding 2.4, but 11AX has adopted both 2.4 and 5, and also there is talks of using some unlicensed spectrum in the 3 gigahertz range for 11AX. Again, it's all from 20 to 160 megahertz bandwidth. The important change is in the modulation where 11AX has brought in 1024 Qualcomm support, and that is a key challenge in terms of implementing the 11AX based products and design. And you see in the design side, the FFT size has increased in terms of like from 512 to 4x improvement. That's because you can see that it has longer symbols, longer duration, and more data processing coming in because of various changes in the spec. Say, the symbol duration is from 3.2 microseconds to 12.8 microseconds with its corresponding guard interval. And as you can see, the guard intervals that 11AX is proposing is from 0.8 to 3.2. That is keeping in mind both indoor and outdoor access for as an application for 11AX. So 11AC, somebody asked a question about why MU MIMO is not so successful. Why it is not? Because it is mainly talking about, it is working in within this thing. So this delay spread actually poses a challenge for MU MIMO because it can work only in very short range where it can give good throughput because of the other overheads involved. But 11AC is trying to address all those and giving you much better throughput and range capabilities. The subcarrier spacing is another important thing. Say the increased throughput and the OFDM symbol duration increase is because the subcarrier spacing has reduced from 312.5 kilohertz to 78 kilohertz in OFDM. And again, this is to increase the range and coverage when we are doing OFDM A access. And having that, quickly to cover on what is OFDM A. So OFDM A is orthogonal OFDM with multiple access. So I'll go in detail about it. It is about the users being, MU MIMO talks about users being spatially multiplexed, and OFDMA talks about users being frequency multiplexed. And the number of spatial stream support doesn't change. Another new thing that has come in 11AX is downlink and uplink MU MIMO in terms of beamforming. And the guard interval, whatever we talked about, it has more guard intervals available, but the short guard interval is removed. That is again for the challenges that we face. So backward compatibility wise, 11AC or 11AX, it is always Wi-Fi thinks about backup compatibility until it's very, the legacy thing always. 11AD is probably an exception because of it's totally in different band, but the all other 802.11s are operating either in 2.4 or the 5 gigahertz band. So So they are very much backward compatible. And another key thing that can help in the IoT devices is the TWT for power save methods that can be implemented in the clients. And yeah, just to brief about whatever we talk now. So MU-MIMO is spatial multiplexing. Users are separated in spatial domain. So the all the users are sharing the same frequency spectrum, but it is dictated by the number of antenna on the AP side on how many users can be used and how many streams can be multiplexed across the users. So it will be like one to many with dictated by the number of antenna on the AP side. Again, MU-MIMO uplink, which is the new thing coming in 11AX, has the same, it's almost similar, but there is an add, this again is limited by the number of antenna on the AP side, depending on how many users that we can dictate to. And always number of antenna, number of users equal to number of antenna, the performance is not really great. So it will be always like the number of users less than the total number of antenna available at the AP side that you get the best throughput and best gain in terms of having a multi-user scenario. And in OFDMA, it has the advantage of doing the OFDMA, where, as we just talked about, it is the frequency multiplexing in terms of using the same frequency spectrum across multiple users, and also spatial multiplexing. So we can technically do this along with this in OFDMA, both uplink and downlink actually. So that brings in a real big complexity. That is the key, the biggest challenge probably for anybody implementing a 11AX system. Either it is, the challenge starts right from very low level to the chip design to all the way to the system, validation, deployment, all those things actually. Again, just briefing the same in terms of MU-MIMO is multiplexed in spatial domain, OFDMA is multiplexed in frequency domain. Downlink was already present in 11AC. Uplink is newly added in 11AX MU-MIMO. OFDMA is completely new and only available in 11AX. 11AX, as I said, is backward compatible. 11AX also supports OFDM with 11AX protocol. That is also available. So it's not that OFDM is not available in 11AX. OFDM is as is available with 11AX header formats and spacing and all the file level things. And OFDMA is an added thing into the 11AX. And maximum number of users in 11AC, it was supporting only 4 users in terms of the multi-user MIMO. But 11AX brings in up to 8 user support. That is again more context. And in OFDMA, this number of users can go, depending on the bandwidth, there is something called resource allocation, resource units that is used in 11AX. And you can see the number of users can go up to 74 if we are using a 160 megahertz 8x8 bandwidth. And streams per user, it is still maintained the same, is number 4. Like you can have a maximum as a single user working up to 4 streams, either in OFDMA or MU, either way, downlink, uplink in all these cases. So just coming in deep about these challenges, where in 11AC we implemented only downlink MU-MIMO. In 11AX, to stick to the protocol and to make use of the advantage of the new standard, the design is going to have both uplink and downlink MU-MIMO. So key difference is there is only one transmitter. AP does all the transmission, all the beamforming and everything. But in 11AX, when we come to uplink and downlink MU-MIMO, it is going to be the AP doing one set of things. The star side, it is also going to do another set of things. So there will be 2 transmitters. And downlink MU-MIMO had a sounding and steering sequence, which became an overhead when we went into long ranges and when we went into lower rates, because the overhead was simply not applicable. So you could very well disable MU and then get the same throughput or even better throughput. But in uplink MU-MIMO, there is an additional HE trigger. Again, the overheads of downlink MU-MIMO still remains in 11AX. It is still the same. The OFDMA is the one that is going to give you more advantage than having the downlink MU-MIMO. But in scenarios, in home scenarios, where you have a AP fixed and you have a TV and a gaming unit, where all these are fixed and within in the short range communication, both of these are going to be, like the downlink MU-MIMO and uplink MU-MIMO still will be relevant and still can provide you the advantage, but the complexity of implementation comes when you do the uplink MU-MIMO, where you have to handle an additional frame. There is another trigger frame and its associated protocol that needs to be taken care at the system level from the Mac to the PHY, which is going to have its own complexities. And then in terms of the downlink MU-MIMO, there was no receiver complexity. It was all like mostly transmitter complexity, where it is only about the beamforming, how you phase align and phase differ the beam and target it towards one user and then have a null projected to the other user. So that was the technique used in downlink MU-MIMO. So there was no bigger receiver complexity. The receiver side, it is only implementing this additional protocol, like responding to the sounding and the steering sequence, collecting those kind of channel information and feeding it back to the AP. But when we come to the uplink MU-MIMO, there is a time and frequency synchronization requirement that comes in, because imagine one to many is much easier than many to one. So the AP has to know, like, if all of them are coming at the same time, how does it synchronize? So that synchronization brings in a key challenge for the implementation. And the second thing is, even though there is transmit power control that is part of the spec that we want to meet across all the devices, still from one device to another device, there is a spec relaxation even when there is a transmit power control. And how do you, how, as a receiver, it becomes very complex. Say it is going to receive signals from multiple, Wi-Fi energy from multiple guys, which are going to arrive at different power level. It is still the single AGC that is going to do the gain control and listen to all these guys, still understand what is that, what is the data that is coming in, and then take decision. Or basically, to maintain the throughput, the receiver sensitivity is the most complex thing. And this is not only for uplink MU-MIMO again, the uplink OFDMA also has the same challenge when it comes to on the uplink side. And in terms of downlink MU-MIMO, it already had its challenges. As I said, when do you decide to do the MU? When you actually group an user based on their relative positioning, like you know where these users are by beamforming and stuff. So you group the user by rate and by range kind of thing. But still, the AP had some amount of control when it was doing it. I wouldn't say it is simpler, but when we look at what needs to be implemented for the uplink MU-MIMO, it was much more simpler when actually 11AC downlink MU-MIMO was done. So for uplink MU-MIMO, now AP has to also start thinking about how each station is going to transmit, where they are, how they are, and there is some power control that is given. So all this additional information that AP has to keep in mind, it is both software system implementation complexity as well as the hardware implementation complexity, where anything that increases the an interaction between AP and station before the actual data transmission is going on, that itself makes sure that it is complex. And so there was no antenna requirement on the station side when downlink MU-MIMO. So even if we had a mobile phone that is like having an one antenna, it's one by one, one stream capable device, it could still be a downlink MU-MIMO capable device, because only AP was doing it. The beamforming was from the AP side, where the multiple antenna was there and it was able to do the downlink MU-MIMO. But when we come to uplink MU-MIMO, the key requirement is the station needs to have at least two antenna, even if it is a single stream device. So that adds the station's complexity in terms of the, you have to have that, even if, say, a mobile phone can typically do with a single stream capability, but if it's going to have an uplink MU-MIMO capability, it will still have two antenna implemented. That is a cost on the mobile side. Again, that is another challenge. And in terms of lab validation, this is the key which we face really, right? Say, for downlink MU-MIMO's validation, the lab validation is very simple. Like, we can put a Butler channel or any known channel. The modeling is very easy, so that it's because it's one directional. But in terms of the uplink MU-MIMO, we can imagine that how do we even do this? You can have four devices. The real use case and real measurements on uplink MU-MIMO can happen only in real use case scenarios rather than a lab scenario. Lab scenario is never going to give us the required, or it is not going to show us the actual performance, really. The only the real use case when we go into the over-the-air scenario where AP is in a fixed point. It is listening from four different devices. The AP has a challenge of listening to all the four out of its all the four antenna or how many ever antenna that the AP side is implementing. And the receiver has to process the at that time is when we know the real challenge or real overhead that is happening because of our MU MIMO. In a lab environment, it is never going to show us the challenge of validating this. Moving to OFDM versus OFDMA, as I said, OFDM is still the modulation scheme in 11AX, but difference between OFDM and OFDMA is in OFDM, entire spectrum is shared to a single user, but now in OFDMA, the spectrum is divided into subcarrier chunks, which are called resource units or RUs, and you can allocate each RU to different users. And that splitting, again, is the spec is clearly defined how we want to split. Say, you can have 26 tone, 52 tone, 106, 242. It just goes increasing order, like different splits. And for the ease of these splits, there are DC carriers and then H carriers that we don't use because it's again coming from, if you go through the standard, you will know how these things are coming from. This is like how to make use of the carriers. We cannot use odd number of carriers and all those things. And the split is like in a 20 megahertz, you can go up to, the lowest is 8 users. Yeah, the lowest is 8 users in 20 megahertz. And entire spectrum allocating is just like the OFDM still. And key challenge when we come to this OFDMA, some of those challenges are common to uplink MU-MIMO. Some of the challenges in uplink MU-MIMO are common for the OFDMA uplink also. But in OFDMA, so the in Wi-Fi world, there is no clock synchronization that is mandated in the spec in 11AX, but LTE has a very, 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 very strict requirement. Now, with OFDMA, when we are doing some uplink transaction with OFDMA where the spectrum is shared across multiple users, both in uplink as well as downlink, there is high susceptibility to frequency and clock offset. So the CFO and the SFO corrections that is getting implemented in the real hardware becomes very, very critical. So there, a lot of work needs to go in there, actually. And the power consumption, it just increases at every level because the design complexity itself is increasing. What we see is in 11AC, though it supported up to 8 streams, 8x8 capability, not many people came up with products that can have that 8x8 capability. But with OFDMA coming in and with for high density environment deployments, what we see 4C is probably more and more 8x8 devices would come in for 11AX. That is a clear possibility. And if we have to completely use the entire standards full throughput capability, that is very much a possibility. And imagine that when people start implementing, the power consumption is going to increase. Already, because of the FFT size and the capability to the capability required at the access point side to handle more users, more streams, more chains, all those things is going to increase the chip power consumption. But the system power consumption also will increase because when we go to 11AX, it supports 1024 QAM. For 1024 QAM, we need to have a very tight RF specs, both for transmit and reception. So there is in the following slide. So for 1024 QAM, the EVM spec requirement is minus 35 dB for a SU case, for 1024 QAM single user case. And for meeting that, the linearity of the PA, that the front end modules that is used, has to be very, very good. And when that happens, the PA has to burn more power to maintain its linearity, or else the linearity will go for a toss at temperature, at different use case scenarios. And the system design complexity also increases. See, like when we do 8-chain device, we can easily say it's an 8-chain device and you see 8 antenna sticking out of the box. But the box cannot be as huge as this stage. The box will still remain the same size of what we see, what we are used to seeing a normal access point that is put in, or normal enterprise access point, even if you see it. It will be sticking to some corner, a small device which is like probably half a feet by half a feet maximum, or maybe even 1 foot long. So when we do this, right, the system design complexity, when you have to put in 8 antenna, And Srikant sir talked about having three radio devices. So imagine there is, to take the full use, you use an 8x8 on one band, another radio that can also be 4x4 or 8x8 in another band, and another radio for the backhaul purposes when people start implementing these mesh kind of networks. So the design complexity, the system design complexity is huge. You have to maintain an isolation from the RF side. You have to have the power consumption taken into account. The PoE enterprise mostly looks at PoE, but they want all the capabilities. They want all the advantages and still stick to the PoE budget. There are works in progress where they use PoE 2, PoE 3 kind of specs are coming in where you can draw a little bit more power by some kind of adjustment techniques that is being talked around. So that is still possible, but still you to maximize that utilization, you have to, the system also keeps growing. Say somebody devising a system with 25 watt PoE budget, within 25 watt PoE budget, the system that is designed for that is already meeting exactly the 25 watts. So somebody who is going to use a 35 watts, he will probably design a system that is close to 35 watts without no room for margin. So it has to be very tight in system design so that the power doesn't even exceed or go beyond few milliwatts. That amount of tighter design complexity is coming in. And going to the next level at the Mac level and the firmware level, when you are going to talk to so many users and the capability that is coming in with very high throughput and everything, your scheduling and rate control kind of things, like what rate I talk to this guy, what is the rate I talk to this guy, because these guys can be in different range, different locations. So the rate control and the scheduling, when I talk to this guy, there are ways where in OFDMA uplink, there are ways where you can switch off the other device and ask him to wake up only when that guy, you actually need the data. So now AP has to also schedule those things. From access point side, the scheduling of those things are also very, very essential. So those kind of complexities are also coming in. And validation, so how do you validate? Say, how do I even validate in lab, in a lab environment, a user like 37 or 74? Where do I put it? Like, how do I really say I am covering the entire range for this particular user, for this particular use case? So, and how do I model an outdoor channel? Like outdoor channel is cannot be modeled that easily, like as much as we can model an indoor channel. How do I mix a short range and long range modeling? So those are some of the challenges that are really faced in terms of 11AX system designing. So I'm just, whatever we talked about, I'll just still again listed it here in quick nutshell. So probably a couple of minutes to come. So 1024 QAM, we talked about, it is bringing in very strict EVM spec. The multi-user EVM spec will be even more tighter because there people want more margin so that the multi-users are really giving you the required performance. And tighter phase noise, PPM is the clock offset, and other RF requirements. And to maintain this spec, at the chip design side, you need to have algorithms that can take care of mitigating any of the impairments to very, very tight level. So only that way we can actually achieve these tighter specs both in EVM and the receive side. In downlink MU-MIMO, more multi-users, up to 8 MU, 8 SS again. So again, more context, more channel information that the Phi and the Mac needs to exchange and store within the thing. So it becomes a memory intensive design, and grouping and scheduling challenges again, as always with any multi-user scenarios. It is exponentially increasing with every user added to the pool. And RU allocation, again, it also brings in the scheduling and rate control challenges. But other key challenge is the transmit power control. How do you maintain on your transmit to different users? Also, how do we make sure that all those transmitters that are doing OFDMA uplink also have a very good transmit power control? And OFDMA for Wi-Fi itself, it was brought in because LTE had it. LTE was the challenge for Wi-Fi, LTE-U and LAA. So they said OFDMA can be implemented for Wi-Fi. But Wi-Fi doesn't have strict RF spec like LTE in different senses. Say for an example, LTE will have plus or minus 2 ppm, I guess, but Wi-Fi says plus or minus 20 ppm in clock offset. So that level of relaxation is there. But at the same time, you have to work on something equivalent to LTE by OFDMA. So that is another challenge that is bringing in for the system design people, like maintaining these requirements. Some more challenges on the design side with these things, right? More area, more power consumption, the CFO and SFO correction capabilities, and RX complexity that we talked about, being different transmit powers and different guys sending. The higher intercarrier interference, we saw that subcarrier spacing has been reduced by 4. So that intercarrier interference becomes a challenge whenever we are designing a receiver. Front-end requirements are getting complex, and the CFO also impacts the SFO. Antenna isolation is a key challenge at the system level. When you put 8 antenna, as I said, in a small box, how do we do the antenna isolation? How do we make sure the MU channel information that is even got from the other guy is valid? Because there will be a shadow of one antenna over other when you are placing 8 antenna. So the transmission or projection of a null to some user over other user becomes a challenge. Interoperability requirements, because the spec has a lot of open and still it is in draft stages. So you will have a lot of IoT challenges when we work with the devices from different vendors. And another key challenge is the backhaul challenge. So 11AX projects 10 gigahertz. So if you want to use 10 gigahertz of bandwidth, you need to have a 10 gig Ethernet bandwidth. So that backhaul becomes a big challenge. But it's not easy at a system level. You put a 10 gig Ethernet and also Wi-Fi with all interferences coming in from these devices, because the harmonics will fall into the 2.4 gig and the 5 gig bands, creating issues for the overall system. Having said all these challenges, design challenges do come with every advancement of technology, but the advantages of 11AX looks to outweigh these challenges with increased penetration of Wi-Fi, speed, and more user capability is the need of the hour, and that is being provided by 11AX. At least as of today, that is the talk.
Thanks, buddy. Yeah, we have time for questions.
So please raise your hand. Anubhav, I have a mic here. Please switch it on.
There are two questions.
Hello. Thanks for the presentation regarding the AX standards. Thank you. One small question regarding the MIMO. So you told there's a challenge on testing the uplink MIMO. So in the AC side, we use a sort of Butler matrix to do the basic validation.
Correct.
So when you go for a multi-user MIMO, so what could be the challenge to implementing on that?
In a downlink MU MIMO, Butler channel can still be used on uplink MU MIMO. I don't deny that. But downlink MU MIMO, the Butler channel was a good enough representation where we can split the antenna from the AP side going into 4 different users. You can connect each antenna out of the Butler to 4 users, all of them may be a 1x1 user, and still do it. But when we come to uplink MU MIMO, that is not the case. Like, AP is now going to listen out of all the 4 guys.
Correct.
Out of all the 4 antenna, the channel is still usable, but that channel is not going to actually rightly represent the use case. So for the use case validation, you really need to go to an over the air scenario where how the antenna, the null projection from the station side is working. That cannot be really seen with the
That's what that. So that means you're suggesting to go for the inside out of chamber, we need to keep all the clients.
Yes.
The RF controlled environment is required.
Correct.
So within that, if we have 3 clients which are connected to the AP, so how we can control that and consolidate the throughput overall requirement from the AP side?
Okay. So the throughput overall requirement is not from the AP side. What we have to find out is what is the throughput gain that we get by using the uplink MU MIMO, rather, right? That will be your interest is what is the advantage of using a single user case with these 3 guys to multi-user scenario. Isn't that the requirement that you have? Rather than the throughput itself cannot be made as a requirement at the
and basically, if you want to benchmark my in the AP side, so how much I'm able to serve to the 3 clients.
Correct.
So I need to get the maximum, correct? So obviously, I require to have some figure to benchmark the throughput in the RF controlled environment.
Correct.
Yeah. Can we take one next question? Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Hello. Yeah. Hi. You mentioned for 1x1 special stream, you need to have 2 antennas for uplink MIMO. Can you please?
The station side. right?
Yeah, can you please explain why do we need a two antenna?
No, actually from, okay. So this is what you're questioning about, right? So even if it is a single stream, for the uplink MU MIMO to be successful, still the number of users are defined by the number of antenna on the access point side. So you cannot have more than four users. But on the station side, for accurately projecting the beamformed data to the AP, a single antenna may not be able to do the beamform. You need more than one antenna to actually do the beamforming. That is the real requirement there, actually.
Does the station beamforming to the access point? Because the sounding is already done by the access point,
correct?
Not the station. So. Sure.
So my question is just to add one more complexity. Do you support carrier aggregation? I mean, that's something which is not really, or a band aggregation which is not utilized in this technology.
So carrier aggregation is not so much in like an LTE-like context, but we have bandwidths, we have concepts similar like carrier aggregation where we do 20, 40, 80, 160, and 80 plus 80. That continues for 11AX.
Okay.
It's very different. It's only contiguous carrier aggregation except for the 80 plus 80 case.
Okay, thank you.